It's Fran in the lab, but this video is about something I did yesterday that was not in the lab. I had a very interesting experience. I had a set of EMG tests done on both of my arms and hands, and it was a very unusual and educational experience. It was quite electrifying. It's electrifying! What exactly is the EMG test and what is it for? Well, it's really a set of lots of different little tests. Mine, actually, I've done two arms, took about 3 hours. It's really meant to test the speed at which nerve impulses pass through the major nerves, in this case of my arms, which is the radial nerve, the median nerve, and the ulnar nerve. And it was done on both hands. And these series of tests reveal impulses that are shown up on a screen because there is there's like two major parts of the test. One part of the test is a little more passive, where sensors, little pickups, are put on various nerves in the hand, and then a stimulator is used to cause a electrical pulse in the nerve further up the arm in various points, and then the signals are received by those sensor pads, and you see a graph on a screen which shows the difference in the timing between those two pads. And when they put the pads on the hands, they're very specifically spaced. So, I mean, there's lots of measuring for not only where the receiving pads are, but also marks on the arm where the stimulator will be put. And then those known distances are used to calculate the speed at which the impulse is traveling through the nerve, and also variations in the intensity of how much of that pulse is picked up by the nerve further on down the line. And by taking lots of samples at different points in the hand and the arm, we're able to determine the efficiency of the various nerves and also detect problems in the nerves. That's kind of interesting. Why is it that we're detecting speed, that the idea that the nerve impulses change speed? Nerves are very interesting, complex structures. They're made up of neurons, which are individual little nerve cells. But in nerves, you've got a bucket brigade of, you know, billions of neurons. I assume there's billions of neurons in the human body. And these neurons are strung together, but they don't actually like physically touch each other, because it's an electrochemical transmission. The electrical impulse begins in a nerve cell, and that's transmitted down the cell's axon as a pulse, but then it has to be transmitted to the next neuron, which it is not in actual like physical contact with, so there is a little gap in there, a synapse, by which one neuron transmits to another using chemical transmission across that gap. And so there's this electrical chemical bucket brigade transmission process that goes through the nerve every time that we send an impulse from our brain, or in the case of the test, that's stimulated artificially with a little stimulator. Now, I did ask the technician about the voltages and such. I could see on the screen, as he would change the stimulation, the current, and it was ranging from, you know, like in the single milliamp range upwards of like 60, 70, 80 plus milliamps. And when it would get over like 60 milliamps, it would become very painful. It would cause a violent contraction in the muscle. And when he got, in some cases, went up to like 80 milliamps, it was like it was really jerking. So if I had to make like a major Hollywood motion picture to dramatically like depict the experience, something like this. But it's not quite that dramatic. It feels like that. And actually, I asked him how much voltage is being used, because you can see on the screen the pulse width, you know, the pulse duration, and the amperage in milliamps. I asked him how many volts this was, and he said he really didn't know. And I went on Google and tried to look up really exactly how much voltage they use on the stimulators on these EMG machines. And it's weird, because I really couldn't find any data. If you look on the Wikipedia page or any other page, you'll find like the pickup voltages, which are picked up by the pads, or that are transmitted through the nerves in the microvolts range. But that's not what the stimulator is sending through the skin. I've been shocked a lot in my life, you know, and so I've gotten a good idea just based on electrical shock, you know, about what the voltage is. It felt like, I mean, it varied a lot, but when the amperage was up like around 80 milliamps, it felt like in the range of like 40 or 60 volts DC. I mean, that's what it felt like. But again, I couldn't find any like definitive like description of the voltages that the stimulators are using on the skin to actually initiate those impulses, which are picked up on the pads as in microvolts. But that is the one part, and that's like two-thirds of the test, like by I guess like 2 hours worth, was using this stimulator and moving the pads around. Some of the arrangements were very complex with lots of different detectors and such on the hands. But then the second phase, the more unpleasant phase, was when they would switch to doing the intramuscular stimulation, in which they use an electrified Teflon-coated needle, which is plunged into, like through the skin and into the muscle, various muscles. There were 7 muscles on both arms that they put this long needle into, and that was very unpleasant. But the interesting thing about that part was, rather than having the oscilloscope type graph of the nerve impulse, there was an audio component where they had a speaker there and a volume control, and it was not that because they weren't using like an artificial stimulator, that intramuscular probe was picking up nerve impulses that were transmitted by my brain, and it was coming out of the speaker as this crackly sort of noise, like white noise. It was kind of like a crackle crackle. It sounded like, you know, like television static, you know, like from a light crackling, like from like a Geiger counter, like on a radioactive source, these clickety clicks up to like television static, and these were the sounds of impulses from my brain, because when he'd have the probe in the muscle, he would have me flex that muscle, whichever one it was, and as I would flex the muscle, you would hear the sound of the electrical impulses coming from my brain to the muscle. I thought that was really fascinating. It was extremely unpleasant to experience on the physical level, but I was fascinated by hearing the sounds of my own like brain impulses going through these nerves into these muscles, and it sort of displayed. I didn't have like I couldn't use the camera during this intramuscular part because my hands and arms were occupied. But it displayed on a graph kind of like an Audacity, like if you're familiar using like Audacity or any kind of like digital recording program, they have like this bar that goes across the screen kind of showing the sound. It was like that, and they recorded the nerve impulses that way. And that very fascinating, very unpleasant. Well, yeah, it was fairly unpleasant. It's not quite like that, but it was it was fairly unpleasant. Like a 3 hour long process. This is kind of interesting. This particular graphic shows 2 samples of the same part of this test using the stim on the same nerve. And the upper one was taken when my hands were cold at room temperature. They had the air conditioning on. It was like 68 degrees or something. It was really cold in there. And my hands get very cold. And so They took one reading when my hands were cold, and then he had me go in another room, and he ran some hot water, like 95 degrees in this tap, and had me put my hands under there and for a good few minutes and get my hands up to, maybe 10 degrees or so. And then we quickly went back in there, set it up, and took a sample of the very same nerve, and that's the lower one, and the length of that pulse, at the base of that pulse, is the timing of the nerve between those two sensors. And so it showed that when my hand was warmer, like 10 degrees warmer, there was a significantly measurable increase in the speed at which the neurons were firing. It was very interesting because just like, reptiles that get cold, they start to slow down, when they get cold, or insects, when they get cold, they slow down. And the reptile, cold-blooded animals, when they seek the heat, they start revving up, and get, their metabolism gets up and the speed of their, of their nervous system increases. So we're the same way. It was very fascinating to see data like that. It was very interesting getting myself troubleshooted on an oscilloscope. I'd done that so much in my life, troubleshooting circuits, but never had my own circuits troubleshot before. So it was a very interesting experience and very educational on many levels. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed this one. If you happen to be going in for an EMG, or if you're going to, need an EMG, it's, maybe gives you a little bit of insight into, what you're gonna experience, but don't worry about it. It's a very survivable experience, and I found it to be very fascinating and educational, especially if you talk to the person doing the test, and you learn a lot about yourself. So anyway, that's it for this one. Thanks for watching. Thanks to all of those patrons right down there on the Patreon. Thank you so much to all my patrons who support the channel and keep the lights on, these very lights. You're paying for these very lights, my patrons. It's the only reason that I'm able to do these videos, is because of the people who support me, the many, many, many wonderful fans who support me on Patreon. If you want to become a patron, it's really easy to do. Just follow the link in the description. Become a patron. All right. That's it. I'm Fran. I'll be back here real soon with another video for you. Bye! In the lab. That's where I work. Berserk in my lab, it's where I work. I'm Fran.